Hey guys, Andre from High Performance Academy. Welcome along to another one of our webinars. Now, today we're going to be addressing one of the topics that I know a lot of tuners struggle with, which is how to get great, crisp, cold start performance that replicates what the factory do. So we're going to get into that shortly and we'll share a few tricks and tips. Today we are going to be working on the Heltec Elite 2500 platform in our Subaru STi, which hopefully you've been able to see while you've been waiting for this webinar to get started. Before we jump into our webinar though, I just wanted to touch on a few things that have been going on over the last week to keep you up to date. And one of the first things I wanted to touch on, because we do get asked about this quite often, is an Instagram that I put up last week, which is a shot that I took at TX2K of the Titan Copper Supra. So we'll head across to my laptop screen and have a quick look at this. And it's really, on face value, not too much to look at here. We are looking at a teal external wastegate, but the part that is a little unusual is that teal external wastegate is mounted on the intercooler charge plumbing. So obviously wastegates and turbochargers go pretty much hand in hand, but more traditionally we see them mounted on the exhaust side of the plumbing, so that it's controlling the exhaust flow through the turbine of the turbocharger, and hence it controls turbo speed and boost pressure that way. So this is something we see used quite regularly on high boost turbocharged drag engines in particular, and usually this will be also on a small capacity engine fitted with a large turbo. And the reason for this is that getting good control over the boost pressure during the launch phase or the staging phase of the drag run is critical, particularly these cars that are using a slipper style drag racing clutch and a drag gearbox such as a Liberty air shifted box, which is what's in the Titan Supra. This requires for consistency that the car always leaves the line at exactly the same engine RPM and exactly the same boost pressure. In other words, what we're trying to do is make sure that the engine's developing exactly the same power when the driver drops the clutch. If the engine power changes from one run to the next, it's actually going to have quite a dramatic effect on the clutch setup. With these slider style or slipper style drag racing clutches, it's possible for the crew chief to adjust both the base pressure on the clutch as well as the amount of centrifugal weight. So in other words, the clutch will actually lock up harder as the engine RPM increases, and getting this all right is a really fine balance. So back to our external wastegate. What happens with our staging strategy when we are using a two-step launch limiter is that the ECU is using a lot of ignition cut and ignition retard in order to help build boost. And basically how this works is that it passes unburned fuel and air through the combustion chamber and it explodes in the exhaust. So this is how it provides pressure and exhaust energy to the turbocharger in order to help spool it. It's very effective, but because we are getting these sharp spikes in pressure in the exhaust manifold, it also causes spikes in the energy created or delivered to the turbocharger, so it's very hard for us to control the boost pressure absolutely rock stable. So this can end up with the boost pressure fluctuating a few psi up and down, or even more so depending on the actual strategy being used. And the external wastegate here on the charge plumbing is used to help control that boost pressure. So the external wastegate will open and vent excess airflow or excess boost pressure so it doesn't actually reach the intake manifold. So by manipulating the spring pressure inside the external wastegate, and in this case you can actually see on the top of the wastegate, it's actually got a screw adjuster, so there's quite a good ability for the team there to finally adjust the boost pressure that's being achieved there. And you'll see that this all runs back to a little three-port solenoid, so this is only active during the launch stage. So as soon as the driver sidesteps the clutch, that external wastegate will close, and then the boost control is done via an external wastegate as you'd conventionally see. Now, one of the questions I got asked when we posted this up is, can the wastegate on the intercooler plumbing like this be used for boost control as the car goes down the track? Well, the actual specific question was for a circuit racing application, and the answer there is no. We don't want to do that, because by venting off excess boost pressure in this way, what you're going to end up doing is overspeeding the turbocharger. So that's not going to be something we want to be doing regularly as the car's going around a racetrack. This is only used for a very small part of the boost control strategy, only during staging. And at that point, we're also well within control of the actual turbo speed. So that's important to mention there. Right, I'll just to keep get you up to date, I should say, on our Toyota 86. So if you've been following us over the last few weeks, you'll know that I've been talking about the TTI 6-speed sequential box upgrade. Hasn't been as easy as we would have liked, and the car has been rounded our fab shop at the moment, or for the last couple of weeks actually, getting that installed. So if we'll go across to my laptop, we've got the installation there at the moment. We can see, hopefully you'll be able to see, that a little bit of manipulation was needed to the trans tunnel there. In particular, basically there is some bracing that needed to be cut out of the factory trans tunnel just to give us a little bit of clearance around the gearbox. And at the moment, the cross member that you can see in this photo here is the cross member that we were using on the existing Toyota R154 box. So it actually lines up pretty well in terms of the height, but of course, as you can see there, it sits a little bit further rearward than the TTI mount. So this required an L-shaped mount bracket to be made up by our fabricator. And another tip there as well, it's really important to understand, is when we do make a mount like this for our gearbox, we want to make sure that we have some rubber isolation or some nolefin bushing in there, just to allow the inevitable movement and flex, particularly in the fact that if the engine is rubber mounted or isolated from the chassis, the gearbox has to be as well, otherwise we're going to end up with cracking. So this is another shot of the gearbox there, and just in place, making sure that it all sits nicely, ready to go. So we're pretty excited to get that back. We've still got a few little steps in that journey. Once we get it back, we've got to still modify the shifter that we looked at last week, the single shifter that goes along with this TTI box, make sure that that's going to fit into the trans tunnel nicely. And then of course we need to have a drive shaft made up to suit. So we are getting dangerously close to being ready to roll with this car. So pretty excited about getting that back on the track. And while we are also on my laptop screen here, or back on my laptop screen, I should say, another couple of things that have been going on. For those who have been following us, you will know that we do have a turbo kit for our Mazda FD RX7, and that is hopefully going to be getting some progress pretty soon. So we're pretty excited because we are running what is still, I think, the one and only BorgWarner EFR 8474 turbocharger that is in New Zealand. We think this is going to be a pretty great combination to go along with the 13B engine in our FD RX7. And one of the problems with any turbo installation, but it is kind of magnified, I think, really in rotary applications, because they do create so much heat in the exhaust, is just managing that heat. And we've all probably seen turbo beanies fitted to the exhaust housing, the turbocharger. Reasonably effective to a point, as long as you're using a good quality one, but we wanted to go one step further and also isolate or insulate the exhaust manifold. So what we've got here is a set of moulded heat shields that Turbosource actually produce. These ones are suited obviously to the BorgWarner, the external Wastegate style exhaust housing for the 8474 turbocharger. So these are an Inconel moulded heat shield, so they do a really great job of isolating or insulating the heat. They don't take up a lot of room, they're not bulky, and unlike some of the turbo beanies that I have had experience with, there's no chance of these heat shields actually melting. They're also really low profile, so they don't take up a lot of room. So that was the turbocharger. We've also got a matching pair of heat shields that will go around the exhaust manifold itself. So this is going to hopefully do a pretty good job of containing and controlling our exhaust temperatures, particularly in the engine bay there, hopefully making sure that we're not going to end up melting any other components. And it's also a really nice aesthetic setup, makes it really easy to fit and control those temperatures. Lastly, while we're on the subject of our FD RX7, we did get our order of components from Turbosmart. So we've got a couple of Comp-Gate 40mm external wastegates here, which will go onto that Turbosource Turblown exhaust manifold. Now, we have also chosen here, as you might see if you're a bit eagle-eyed, we do have the sensor cap for these particular external wastegates. So This allows us to fit a wastegate position sensor, and this will be wired up to the ECU fitted to the car. And this is just another tool in our data logging strategy and can be quite helpful, particularly when you are diagnosing boost control issues, just seeing exactly what those wastegates are doing when the car is in operation. So pretty excited to get that data and see exactly what's happening there. And of course, once we've got that FD RX7 up and running, it is going to be used for creating some course content and some webinar content. We know that we've got a lot of people constantly requesting more information on rotary tuning specifically. And on that note, we will be getting started there with an adaptronic modular series ECU in the RX7. But as usual, we will have the ability to swap between a variety of different ECUs so that we can bring out content on the platforms that we are getting requested most often. Now, an update on our Subaru STi. Pleased to say that finally we have got it up and running. It was a pretty big job in comparison to what I expected. We had a few little hurdles that we had to work our way through, but we're up and running now, and we are currently running on the Haltech Elite 2500 ECU via our adapter harness. I've had the car on the dyno just to get a baseline configuration into it and a bit of a tune in it, so it is going to be drivable, ready for our webinars. And of course, we will be creating some course content on the Haltech Elite ECU. This will be a worked example added into our practical standalone tuning course. We are also going to be making an adapter harness here for an ECU Master Black ECU. So we're pretty excited to get that fitted up. It's an ECU that we have done an unboxing on. So if you want to learn a little bit more about that, check out our YouTube channel, search for ECU Master Black. But it's also one that we haven't had any personal experience with. So while everything at the moment that I've seen I really like, and on paper it's an excellent and very well priced ECU, we want to get some hands-on experience and just see how well all of those features and functions actually stack up in the real world once we get an opportunity to start tuning on one. All right, and on that note as well, I'll just mention, if we can head across to my laptop screen, on terms of our YouTube channel, we have just released one of the videos that I was really excited about at TX2K. This was an interview with JR from Extreme Turbo Systems, ETS, and JR is one of those guys that is a little bit hard to pin down. We've been lucky enough to have two great chances to chat to him now. We talked to him at Pikes Peak Air Strip Attack last year, and had the opportunity to talk to him this year about the ETS G build. Now, for anyone who is following the R35 GTR drag racing scene, particularly in the United States, the ETS G is a brand new build, but there is a little bit of controversy in particular, which we deal with in this video, because this was the old Alpha G AMS built car. So we discuss exactly why it is no longer the Alpha G car, why it is now the ETS G car, and the relationship between ETS and Giddy, the owner of, or the driver, I should say, of the car. It is actually owned by JR of ETS. More importantly, though, we get real deep into the technical aspect of this particular car. It was the fastest car at TX2K, setting a 6.73, I think off the top of my head, at 223 mile an hour, also winning the unlimited GTR class in the process. So we find out what makes that car tick, how it makes 3,000 plus wheel horsepower, and also we talk about some of the intricacies that JR is using in the Civex ECU to get the most out of that, in particular some really interesting strategies around launch control that I've actually never heard of before. So if you're interested in learning more, head along to our YouTube channel, make sure you subscribe while you're there, and give that video a watch. It is a bit long, as with most of our tech tours, around about 24 minutes, but a good chance to sit down, make yourself a cup of coffee, sit back, enjoy, and learn something about R35 drag racing. Right, lastly, we are running another one of our giveaways, this time in conjunction with the team from K1 Technologies. We are giving away a set of K1 connecting rods. So if you are considering an engine build at the moment and you are looking for components for your engine build, this could be a great opportunity for you. This giveaway will include any of their shelf stock sets of rods. So basically, if you have got a popular car, chances are you will be covered by their shelf stock products, and this will also include shipping to you anywhere in the world. So regardless where you are, you don't need to be in the United States. We are also pairing that up with our suite of engine building courses, so you're going to know what to do with those Conrods when you get them. This will include our engine building fundamentals course, our practical engine building course. You're also going to get some access to our gold membership, which is our private online members only community. So it'll give you access to our forums as well as these webinars that you are watching right now. If you want to get your name into the draw, I'll get the guys to drop a link into the comments that you can follow. There's still a little bit of time to go, but don't waste that time. Get in there quickly. You also find there are a list of other things that you can do to give yourself more entries into that draw. So jump on in there, and you never know, you could be the lucky winner. All right, thanks for watching there. Give me a few moments and we'll get started with today's webinar.